one for works of art and performance, and a research category. The winners of each of those categories have moved on to this final event to determine the grand champion. They are going to present live today, head to head, and you're going to see quite a variety of presentations here across a number of projects, because here in our culture of innovation, the way we like to do innovation at UC, it's not all about technology, it's not all about certain people in certain majors. Anyone on campus can be and should be innovative. So you'll see quite a variety here, all the way from portfolio diversification to extracting uranium pollution from groundwater. So with that, I move on here to a little bit of logistics. I had a couple questions how the judging will happen. There is an online form. We'll show this again at the end. So for those of you who are watching online, you can click the link type in the link or scan the QR code. Those who are in person can do that. And if the technology fails us, we do have some printed ballots here for those who are in person. So with that, I want to move on. We'll go to the first presentation. It's Joel Braswell and portfolio diversification.
All right, thank you for the introduction, and thank you very much for the opportunity to do this presentation. I'm excited, and I think this is a really cool thing. All right. So, hello everyone, my name is Joel Braswell. I'm a financial planning student here at UC, and today I'll be giving my presentation on a hypothetical interaction that I had with one of my financial planning clients. And it began something like this. Hello, my name is John, and I'm looking for some help with my investment portfolio. Hello, John, I'd love to help. Let's take a look at your portfolio. Well, as you can see here, I've invested heavily in cryptocurrency because I Googled the top three crypto organizations because I heard that cryptocurrency is gonna be the next big thing. So I went and bought the stock in all three of those companies. But as you can see from my performance history here, I've been doing very poorly over the last month. What's going on? I thought I was supposed to start making money. Well, John, in your portfolio, it seems like you really lack diversification, which has opened you up to a lot of unsystematic risk. And the cryptocurrency market is very volatile right now. Unsystematic risk, volatility, what does that even mean? Can you please explain those to me? Yes, I can. So, starting with volatility. That is the trend in the value of the stock. When a market is very volatile, it means the value of the stock tends to skyrocket up or drop down very regularly. And that happens a lot with the crypto market. And this ties into diversification as well. Think of diversification as the different types of assets, the different industries that you're invested in, the different countries that you're invested in. Think of it like eggs in a basket. So your basket right now is your portfolio, and in there you only have cryptocurrency. If crypto is doing well, that's great, but if crypto does poorly, your basket becomes worthless. But imagine now if you had a basket, a well-diversified basket, which contains stocks in cryptocurrency, the auto industry, manufacturing, technology. That way, if cryptocurrency was to go down, you'd lose some value, but at the same time, the auto industry could increase in value, which could benefit your basket. And this ties into risk. In the market, there are generally two types of risk, systematic risk and unsystematic risk. Systematic risk is what we all experience. It's what happens just by owning a basket, by having a portfolio in the market. Unsystematic risk comes from how well diversified your basket is. And that's my job as a financial planner, to put together a basket for you that's well diversified that will protect you against the unsystematic risk in the market. Thank you, that makes so much sense. So what should I do now? Well, I'll put together a portfolio, and a well diversified portfolio has 15 to 20 different stocks in it. So I'll put that together for you. Thank you very much. You're welcome. And if you have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. So, a few weeks later, my client called me during dinner to voice some concerns that he had about the way that his portfolio was going. Hello? What's going on? My portfolio is tanked completely. We're well diversified, but I'm still losing money. I thought that now that I was diversified, I was supposed to start making money. John, calm down, I'm eating dinner. You can come in tomorrow morning and we can talk about it. The next morning I met with John and we went to go over his portfolio. And I started by saying, do you remember when we talked about systematic risk? Yes, that's the risk on the market. Everyone experiences that. You can't get away from it. Exactly. Well, right now, there's a lot of systematic risk in the market. Most people's baskets, most people's portfolios are not doing well. And that explains why yours isn't doing well. This is why we need time. Why do we need time? Because over time, the volatility in the general market tends to even out. I have some examples here for you. On the top here, you can see this is the S&P 500 over the last year. And there are a lot of ups and downs, and it's pretty volatile over the last year. But beneath here is the last 5 years for the S&P 500. And while there are still many ups and downs, it's a general trend going up. Here is the last 20 years of the S&P 500. And as you can see, there are ups and downs, but there is a consistent, steady trend up. And a well-diversified portfolio should behave the same way. That's why we get diversified, to take advantage of this long, steady trend that occurs in the market. Thank you, that makes so much more sense. I realize now that portfolio investment is about investing for the long haul. I want to be able to fund my retirement portfolio one day, and investing this way is a good way that I can do that. Thank you so much. You're welcome, John. Thank you. Thank you.
And now our next competitor is Logan Bossert talking about uranium and groundwater.
All right. Hi, my name is Logan Bossert, and today I would like to present the research I conducted alongside my advisor, Dr. Xiaoping Sun, on the analysis of the charge transfer from aromatic compounds to uranyl-6 using UV-Vis and fluorescence spectroscopies. And I know a lot of you probably aren't that familiar with this area of study, so I'll try to explain some things in future slides. But first, you're probably wondering, well, how is this innovative? Well, this adds new aspects of study to physical, organic, and inorganic chemistries by employing both aromatic compounds with uranyl using UV-Vis and fluorescence spectroscopies. And a fluorescence instrument is very specialized. Additionally, this is the first time an inner sphere versus outer sphere charge transfer has been observed in uranyl complexes. But most importantly, this could possibly hold the key to reducing uranium pollution in water. So the dangers of uranium poisoning. Uranyl is a highly toxic uranium compound. In the past, hundreds of miners have died due to inhalation of this toxic substance. The problem becomes, how can you detect it and precipitate out of water to reduce pollution? My hypothesis is that a single electron transfer will occur from an aromatic compound to uranyl-6, reducing it to uranyl-5. As a result, strong absorption should be seen in the 300 to 400 nanometer range. This is shown using UV-Vis spectroscopy. Absorption means how much light a compound can take in. Additionally, a phenomenon known as fluorescence quenching should occur, which is when the intensity of a fluorescence compound is decreased by the compound you add to it. Fluorescence is the amount of light emitted, and this is done using fluorescence spectroscopy. Here's a picture of uranyl. It is a linear compound, just so you know what it looks like. So in short, an aromatic compound, which is a ring-like structure, can be added to uranyl and then help precipitate it from water. So here's a brief introduction to what an electron donor acceptor complex is. D stands for donor and A for an acceptor. So the electron, shown by the arrow here, when light is shined on the compound, the electron jumps from the highest occupied molecular orbital, the HOMO, to the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital of the acceptor compound, the LUMO. And as you can see in the picture on the right, the electron has been excited. That is the excited state, and that's where the EDA complex forms. When I was conducting this research, there was two types of charge transfer that we were studying. 90% of the time, the electron is found within the electron cloud, but the other 10% of the time, the electron is found outside. So an inner sphere charge transfer is going to occur when the electron is found inside the cloud because it has an easier chance of reaching the uranium center, which is shown by the green circle right there. So with an inner sphere charge transfer, it forms an EDA complex through a covalent bond. The resulting absorbance is strong and the quenching efficiency is high. But in the case of an outer sphere charge transfer, the electron is found outside of the cloud, making it harder to reach the uranium center. Therefore, no bond can form, no EDA complex happens, and the resulting absorbance is weak with a low quenching efficiency. So now for the results, and hopefully they're a little bit less scary since I explained some stuff. Here's an example of the data treatment done for UV-Vis and fluorescence spectroscopy. Here is the study of the absorbance, and as you can see, there are noticeable changes between each peak, which means that an EDA complex forms. And in the case of the fluorescence intensity, the peaks, specifically the one in the middle, changes a lot with each new trial, which again shows that the charge transfer does occur. So first, the results of pentamethylbenzene, which is pictured on the top. It has a quenching efficiency of 8.694, an EDA complex forms, and it was via an outer sphere charge transfer. Just to set up how efficiency works, if we pretend that 10 is the optimal number, a level of 8.694 falls in that scale there to the right. However, for benzene, which is pictured on the top, the quenching efficiency is only 0.450. The EDA complex does not form, and it's via an outer sphere charge transfer. As you can see, if we were to place it on another imaginary scale, indicated by the red star there, it is a considerably less effective quencher. So what that really means is that my research was pretty successful. We learned a lot. But it's a two-step solution, and we've only completed step one. Step one is to reduce UrNO6 to UrNO5. But to further reduce it to UrNO4, which is the type that can be precipitated out, you have to adjust the pH to disproportionate. However, UrNO can potentially be removed from the water. So what exactly did I accomplish? Well, I accomplished step one of my two-step solution. An aromatic compound can be used to reduce UrNO6 to UrNO5. And a compound that participates in an intersphere charge transfer and forms an EDA complex is going to be more effective than something like benzene with a low quenching efficiency of 0.450. So this research holds a basis for future research in the same topic, as well as future research in innovation and environmental protection. So to me, this means a lot because helping the environment really just makes the world a better place. I would like to thank everyone for coming and thank the judges and thank you for coaching me and thank you for helping me with my research.
Thank you, Logan. Next presentation is Eli Hughes, kind of a cool golf team.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here today, and thank you for this opportunity. And I'd like to tell you about my product, Ease Everlasting Tees. So I like to go out and golf. I like to get to the driving range with my friends and goof around. But let me tell you, I am no good at all. Every time I tee up the ball, this happens to me. And this is the most frustrating thing in the entire world. It's like 100 degrees outside. It's hot. It's humid. It's a beautiful day, really, actually. But my golf game is awful. And when this happens, I just get even more frustrated, and my golf game becomes even worse. And you may be thinking, well, Eli, why don't you use a plastic tee? Well, look at these things. These look like a birthday cake candle. I mean, there's no visual appeal to them. They're made out of plastic, and guess what? Those break too, and I know that because I've tried. But don't worry, though, because there is a solution to this problem that I have come up with. But before we get into that, let me introduce you some statistics about the golf industry and golf tees in general. So 1 in 3 Americans claim to play golf. So that's a third of the U.S. population, which that's a pretty decent amount of people when you think about it. And about 3 billion, with a B, billion golf tees are sold in the United States each year. And the average golfer uses about 6.75 wooden golf tees per round. So per 18 holes, a golfer will use about 7 tees. So that's not very good, and I'm sure that makes his game go down as well. And in 2019, there are approximately 441 million rounds of golf played in the United States. So if you do some quick math here, 441 million times 6.75 gives you about 2.9 billion golf tees used in the United States in 2019. So that makes our 3 billion golf tees statistic true. So that's, you know, an incredible amount of golf played, lots of wooden tees that are broken, and a lot of golf games that were affected by the statistic. But now, like I said, here's my solution to this. Ease Everlasting Tee. What I have created through the Robert C. Byrd Institute is a prototype 3D printed, by the way, that's being passed around to the judges and everyone in the audience. You can see and play with it. Is a plastic infused with rubber golf tee that gives it this little flexible little bend that will help the tee not break and hopefully your golf game to perform better. And now our audience for this, our target market, is not the PGA Tour golfers, because those guys, for one, they can hit off the tee, you know, pretty nicely. Plus, they're rich, so they don't even care how much you spend on golf tees. So, you know, they don't care about this. My target is for the average golfer, someone like myself, likes to go out and just have fun and try to, you know, beat my friends at golf or see who can drive the ball the furthest. Now, you may be asking me, Eli, that's a wonderful design, wonderful concept, but does it work? So here, you see the video here. This is one of E's tees being struck by the driver. And you see how RT, one more time, it bends down upon impact. A normal tee would have broken at this point, wooden or plastic, but not E's tees. And here it is one more time so everyone can see it. Look at that beautifulness. Look, bends down, doesn't break. A wooden golf tee or plastic, like I said, would have broke upon the point of impact. And that's what makes E's tees so different. You're like, okay, Eli, so they have plastic and rubber mixed together, but what's innovative about it? Well, what makes this product innovative is this little chart here. This is the key tenets of innovation, and those are desirability, feasibility, and viability. So desirability, is my tee desirable? Well, 3.9 million tees are sold in the United States each year, okay? So obviously they're desirable, yes. Feasibility, can we make it? Well, as you see from the prototype coming around, we can make it, so it is feasible, it is profitable, as my market research has shown. And is it viable? Is there a business? You know, can we make a business out of this? Well, people have to buy their golf tees from somewhere, so why not me, right? Like, these golf tees aren't gonna break, help them with their golf game. So if you have all those together, you get this little sweet spot, the innovation sweet spot, and right there lives E's Everlasting Tees, and that little sweet spot right there. So also, I've been developing this product. I have been going through and seeing if it is patentable. You know, is there a patent for it already? And to my surprise, there were actually 174 flexible golf tee patents across the United States, Europe, Asia, and Australia, which I never would have thought that, because for one, I've never even seen any sold like Dick's or Golf Galaxy or anywhere. So I was kind of shocked when I saw this. But out of those 174 patents, only one of them rivals E's Everlasting Tees. And I think we have figured out a way to get around that one patent, so we should be really good to go, once we get this going here. So yes, that's E's Everlasting Tee. That's what makes this product so innovative and so desirable for customers and golfers alike. So I'd say thank you for your time from E's Everlasting Tees.
Thanks, Eli. Next up is Colt Webb to talk about mindfulness in sports.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming out today, and I really appreciate the opportunity. My name is Colt Webb, and I'm a psychology major here in the University of Charleston, and I'm also a baseball player. So I chose to do this study on mindfulness in sport because it seems to be a decline in the ability to control emotion, and from what I've seen personally, at least, and I feel as if through mindfulness training, people can be able to implement a way of controlling their emotions. And so mindfulness is a state of being conscious of something and ability to focus in the present moment. And through mindfulness training, which is the technique of applying mindfulness into one's lifestyle through the different exercises, such as meditation, breathing exercises, and motivational videos, and there's so many more, but these are what I focus on. So my research question was, can I see if there's any changes in attitude that can occur over the span of a week when baseball players are exposed to mindfulness training? And so my hypothesis for this is, with mindfulness training, players' level of self-awareness and motivation will increase. So my study is a two-group post-test only experimental design, with my independent variable being mindfulness training versus no training, and my dependent variable was the level of mindfulness once the study was completed. For the study, I had 46 University of Charleston baseball players, and my methods are My study being conducted over the span of a week, which was 5 days of practice, and my participants were given a post-test at the end of the study. My questionnaire was 11 questions. 9 of these questions were positive response questions, which sought a positive answer, and 2 of them were negatively worded, which sought a lower score. So prior to conducting my study, I informed everybody of what was going on. I gave them a sheet that they had to sign, and this was all done individually. And my questionnaire asked them to rate their emotions felt towards practice. So that was on a 5-point Likert type scale. Once the study was completed, I debriefed them, thanked them for their time, and made sure that they knew that if they wanted to come find the results, they could come right to me and I would give it to them. So, as I said before, in my questionnaire, there were 2 types of questions, negative and positive. So the negative questions sought a lower response. An example of that would be rating your level of stress towards practice. And the example of the positive question would be rating your level of motivation felt towards practice. So the type of mindfulness training that I used was a combination of a breathing exercise and a motivational video. And this was done 15 minutes prior to the start of practice. And while they were completing this task, my control group would continue on as if nothing was happening and go on with their day. So to control for chatter amongst my groups, I didn't want them talking to each other, finding out what the actual purpose of the study was. So I asked my coach Britt to talk to them and ask if he could talk to them to see if they would wait until the completion of the study was done so that I wouldn't have to worry about that. So my procedure of the study were to complete a breathing exercise and watch a motivational video prior to physical activity for the span of 5 days. And once they did this, I post-tested them. So to give you a visual, I have a video right here. I'm gonna show about 15 seconds of the motivational video that I showed. Play. There we go.
It is extremely, extremely effective to build. Incentives into whatever behavioral change you want in life, whatever skills you want to acquire. A transformation of the mind. Not accept things as they are.
I have to cut that short.
Thank you for that.
So for my results, this is fun stuff. So for the positive questions, I actually was surprised and I saw no change within the motivation. I didn't see an increase of motivation within the experimental group. And so what I actually found was within the negative questions. So if we look, we see a P statistic, which is down here, which is 0.002. To be significant, it has to be below 0.05. So that shows great significance. And what this means is that the participants who received the mindfulness training actually were able to lower their levels of stress and anxiety felt towards practice on a daily basis. And so, while I did not find significance in the aspect of raising motivation, I actually found an unsuspected thing, which, given the visualization right here, as you can see, the positive questions stayed pretty much the same, but there is a massive gap in between the experimental and control groups right here. And so I thank you for your time, and I appreciate you watching.
And our last, but certainly not least, contestant is Kaylee Knopp.
Hello, everyone. I hope everyone's doing well today. Do I press this one to open this one? Okay, I am not technologically involved, so. So hello, my name is Kaylee Knott, and I am fabricating my future one stitch at a time. The art of embroidery has a rich history and can be used as a time portal to see into our past. Now, this art form goes back to 30,000 BC to a place in China where fast fashion was a thing of the future, but clothing with holes would soon be a thing of the past. Embroidery was developed out of necessity. Our textiles were low, and so in order to make our clothing last longer, we embroidered. Now moving forward into 1323 BC, in Egypt, that is the first time that we see examples of embroidery as art. Apparently King Tut had a taste for embroidery. And then that are not as tasteful as they used to be. And the same with the color schemes. Because what was in fashion then has not always been in fashion now. And that's something that has held true through decades. Another interesting thing that we can look at is our fabric types. So in the 1930s, we saw a development of synthetic fibers. However, before that, everything had to be natural, such as our cottons and our linens. And this is the same thing that is true of our dyes. The way that we dye things is more consistent than how it used to be. And those can be used to date an embroidery piece. There's also the methods that we use of embroidery. I'm sure you can assume that the oldest form of embroidery is something that is hand-stitched. However, with the development of sewing machines, we saw that people were almost attempting to draw with them, as they would take the hoop and then they would move them as a way to trace outlines. And then even further into the future, we see a digitized embroidery machine, which is something that I personally do. Here is an example of a simplified version of my art. So here I have taken a heart and I drew an outline of it. And all of these extra stitches that you can see, those have to be individually placed so that my machine knows where to stitch them out. And the diagonal lines show what stitch it connects to so that they don't overlap. And like I said, this is a very simplified design, but it comes to something like this. So the meet baby Ivor, I know, he's adorable. So the way that I produced this piece is I took a picture of baby Ivor and I traced it out and I colored it. And then I had to do the exact same thing that I did with my heart. So essentially I have to pick my stitch types and I have to pick my colors and my fabric. And then I trace it out digitally with stitches, the same thing that I drew before. And when I'm done with this piece, then I actually have to cut jump threads, which is essentially where something of the same color was started in another place. So for instance, the mouth was stitched out in black, and so was the nose. And so you go through and you cut the jump threads, and then you're going to hoop your piece and sew up the back. Now, I'm sure for Ivor and his family that this piece is going to be a momentum that is carried throughout the centuries. However, whenever years from now somebody picks up my art and they look at it, I hope that they are able to recognize the assimilation of technology and human works. I hope that they can see that the fibers are something of the modern day as well as the colors, and that it is a stitch in time for the 21st century. Thank you.
Okay, five fantastic presentations. So now we'll move for a few minutes into the judging portion. Again, for those online, you can use this web address or the QR code, same in the room. If you are in person here and the technology isn't working for you, we do have paper ballots that you can use. We will take 5 to 10 minutes now and judge those. Please pick your favorite single presentation as it relates to the student's ability to be innovative within their area of interest or within their major. It's a little bit hard with the variety we have here, but please pick one of your favorites. Thanks. Thank you. Has everyone in here got their vote in this room? It looks like everyone online has, but let's take about 2 more minutes just to make sure everybody gets their vote in, and then we'll read the winners.
I'm going to
Okay. I think we have all the votes in. Apparently, there are quite a few online watching as well, which we really, really appreciate. First of all, I want to point out that all of these contestants today have already been winners. They've already won their own categories and received a cash prize for that. Today, we announced the top two, and they will get an additional cash prize. Second place will get $1,000, and first place will get $2,000. So without further ado, second place, the runner-up is Logan Bossert. Congratulations. And we look forward to cleaner drinking water in the future. First place with a pretty significant portion of the vote is Kaylee Knott. So once again, thank you to everybody, in particular our sponsors, our participants, and our judges. We look forward to being able to do this again next year. Maybe next year we'll be able to do everything live and we'll have a big celebration again like we did the first couple years. But thank you for your participation in this year's UCI3 event.